Okay, we are in Duties of the Heart, and we're on page 165. What we were dealing with is three reasons why people don't recognize God. The first one was they're in pursuit of worldly stuff. They don't have time for God, so they don't realize they're always looking for the next new car or the next whatever, next dollar, and that's one reason. The second reason is that we are like wild animals, that we were born and God gives us all these kindnesses, but we don't recognize them because we're so used to them. So we're no better than the wild donkey. That's the second one. So then the third one is that people have problems, so they don't recognize the good stuff that Hashem gives them. All they recognize is the problems that they have. And so therefore they also don't recognize God. Those are the three reasons I was giving. Yeah.
There's other the second one that they think we're no different than animals. What was the first part of that statement?
That just as an animal does not have an awareness of what is being done for him.
So you think everything is just natural and you have your cravings. I want what I want.
Right. He gave the example of the child who somebody takes in as a child and gives him it was an adoption. So he takes his child in and he brings him up and he doesn't take, and the child doesn't recognize the good is being done for him, as opposed to a prisoner who was released by this guy and takes care of him and nurses him back to home. So the one who does that will recognize it much more. So because, you have a new book right here.
Oh, I got my new book.
Oh, you have a new book? So it's on 165. So therefore, he, very good. That's the right one. Okay, and it's volume one. There you go. You're all set.
Everything's good. The world
is right. The world's in balance. So that's what we're looking at. So you don't recognize it. It's just as a child who doesn't recognize his own parents. In other words, he doesn't recognize the good that his parents are doing. What he'll do is will do is complain when they don't get their way, take a temper tantrum, do what they have to do. Small child. It could be a bigger child. It could be an adult child.
Spoiled.
A spoiled child, yeah. I thought he said, this is what we call a spoiled child. So they cry and they get it done because they don't recognize the good. So that's the second reason. And again, the third one is that you have problems in your life and it's not what you expected. You're doing all these wonderful things and you think you're keeping all the laws. You may very well be keeping all the laws too, by the way, I'm not saying you're not. And things still bad things happen to you. It's not what you expect. So you say, so you don't have time, as it were, to look around. You're resentful. He says they're resentful of God's judgment and so on and so forth. And he's going to embellish on that. He said, and that's where we are. How closely they resemble, it's the last paragraph of page 165. How closely they resemble in this regard blind men who are brought to a house prepared for them with everything that could benefit them. Everything in it is arranged perfectly. It is fully equipped and ideally suited to benefit them and provide for their welfare. In addition, effective medications and a skilled physician to administer them are provided for their treatment so that their sight might be restored. Nevertheless, the men neglect to undergo treatment for their eyes and disregard the advice of the physician who has been treating them. They walk about the house handicapped greatly by their blindness, stumbling over the very things that have been prepared for their benefit, falling on their faces. Some suffer bruises, others broken limbs. So you see, I'll continue with this. They suffer much and their troubles are confounded. They complain bitterly about the owner and the builder of the house and condemn his actions. In their eyes, he has been negligent and a poor leader. And they believe that his motivation has not been to do them good and to show them kindness, but to cause them pain and injury. This leads them to deny the benevolence and kindness of the owner. As the wise one Solomon said, even while the fool walks on the road, he has no sense, and he says of everyone, he is a fool. So here, Rav Bachya is giving a very nice indication as to how we should, one, the way you should be viewing all the trials and tribulations in your life is not that Hashem hates you, but rather, like we've said many thousands of times already, that Hashem really loves us, and he only wants the best for us. And sometimes he sets it up, so and we would listen, actually, he always sets it up, so that if we would listen to what we are being told, then we could navigate our life very well, very comfortably, and go on. But if we choose not to listen to the doctors, in this case, the rabbis and how they're interpreting the Torah, so then we are like a fool that's walking around blindly. And then when we start tripping and hurting ourselves, everything else, we blame God, saying that this whole system was just made to play with us. So we're no longer recognizing the good that Hashem is doing for us through our tribulations. Yeah.
Is he giving these as reasons for denying God?
He's giving this as reasons for not looking into God. We're always saying God's there. We're just not appreciating what God does for us.
Okay, so he's not talking about somebody who's outright denying God at this point, but not recognizing the goodness.
As a matter of fact, he's saying you do recognize God.
Ah.
I remember the first gate he gave you, that was Yichud. Yeah. That's when he told you, look, I mean, these are the proofs for God. If you're going to deny them, so you're a fool. I mean, I can't help you, and this book is no longer for you. He told him straight out, this book is no longer for you. So close it, don't leave me alone, return it to Amazon.com, and have a good time, because you're living a lie. And so he's looking for the person who is accepting that there's proofs, that the proofs of God are valid, and now says, okay, let's see why we don't. Okay. If we acknowledge that the proofs are decent, so then there's a next step here, one of reflection,
He's moving on to higher level things.
Right. He's into higher level.
Okay.
He's left the atheist behind.
Okay.
He no longer wants to deal with them. He's already dealt with them. Have a good time. Like I said, like he said, if you don't accept my arguments, close the book. Have a good day.
Yep.
Done. It's done. Stick a fork in the guy's done. No problem. But now he's looking at the person who already accepts the arguments.
Yeah.
Good. So he says, since this is so, it is the obligation of men of wisdom and knowledge to rouse those who fail to perceive the favors of the Creator and to teach people to recognize these blessings intellectually. For there are many blessings which people possess and yet fail to profit from altogether or do not fully enjoy simply because they are not aware of them and do not appreciate their value. Once they are alerted to the many benefits of these blessings and what has been hidden from them is revealed to them, they will sing the praises of and express full gratitude to their benefactor, and as a result, find pleasure and enjoyment in this world and a fitting reward in the next. Now, I want to think about this just on a simple level. Let's say you never knew what a microwave was. You never saw it. Okay? And you walk into a home and you don't see the oven. There is no oven because there's only a microwave oven in the house. That's all they have. And you want a hot tea. Now, a hot tea, if I would take my kettle and put it on the flame, the stove, it would take about it depends on how much I fill the kettle up, but about 5 minutes or a little more for me to walk around the house and to do what I'm going to do until it's ready. But then I have to make a whole bunch of water. I can't just make one glass of tea from that, right?
Yeah.
So I'm looking around and saying, okay, but there's no stove, there's no this, there's that. I want my hot tea, how am I supposed to do it? And somebody comes along and says, you want a hot tea? No problem. They take the cup, the styrofoam cup, they put it, or whatever cup you have, and they put it into the microwave, hit, and hit a minute or two minutes, whatever it takes, done, and here you go. And you're looking, oh my God, if I would have known. Tremendous, I love this tool, what is this?
Right in front of you.
Yeah, right in front of me, it's right there, right, if I would have known. And how long does a potato take? 2 minutes, 3 minutes, four, whatever it takes.
Okay, shorter time.
The point is that it's amazing amount of stuff that we do. I want to talk to my cousin in Israel, but it looks how long as I don't have the opportunity. I have to do what I have to do is I have to write a letter. I have to do this. And someone says, what are you talking about right here? Pick up your phone. Boom. What's this? A phone? What was a phone? Then you go, oh, I can call it and talk to you. Amazing. Amazing. Okay. Once I realize what it is, I now start to be appreciated. Computers. Again, I can look at them as the greatest evil of history or as the greatest invention of history, certainly with the internet. If I want to know, I want to know directions, how to get to a certain place, I just put MapQuest, blah, blah, and I see right away, oh, that's where it is, fine, done. As compared to, driving around in circles or whatever it's going to be. So that's what he's talking about. I'm going to start singing the praises when I start realizing what Hashem has put in front of me and all the benefit that comes. Who couldn't sing praises to that? So the wise man has already stated in this regard, the words of the wise are like goads and like driven in nails are ba'ale asafot. He's going to translate that. Asupot, excuse me. He likened the words of the wise to goads because they arouse and stir up. He likened ba'ale asafot to driven in nails because their ideas penetrate and remain in the heart. And thanks to them, various forms of wisdom are retained by the soul. Who are the ba'ale asafot? It has been explained by Rav Sadia Gaon that they are the authors of the compilations. The first word of the verse, divrei, the words of, must also be supplied in the second half of the verse, which should be answered as follows. And like driven in nails are the words of the compilers, the Shebal Asupot. For the books written about the various branches of wisdom endure and are of lasting value. That is why they are likened to driven in nails. Then it is now my task, Rav Bachya says, to explain the following six aspects of reflection on creation. One, what is the essence and true nature of reflection on creation? Two, is one obligated to reflect on creation? It's another question. Am I obligated? It's just a nice thing to do. Mm-hmm. Three, how does one, if assuming it's obligated, even if it's not, how does one reflect on creation? Four, how many kinds of traces of wisdom in creation are we capable of reflecting upon? Five, which of these is most accessible to us, such that our obligation to investigate it is correspondingly greater? And number six, finally, what inhibits this reflection? What is connected with it? So that's what he's going to be doing for a little while. Number one, we're looking at what is the essence and true nature of the reflection of creation. The essence of reflection on creation is one, contemplation of the signs of the Creator's wisdom manifesting creation, and two, the soul's appreciation of them according to one's power of perception. In other words, the more we work on it, the more we're going to perceive. Okay, so this wisdom, though the traces of it are varied in created things, is fundamental and essentially one. Just as the sun is one in itself and in its essence, though its rays, when passing through white, black, red, or green glass window planes, take on the different colors of the glass, such as the water used to irrigate an orchard abloom with flowers of the different colors will when on the flower assume the color of the flower. So what he's setting up immediately is that it depends, just as the sun has a different spectrum by which we see it, in other words, depending on, we're gonna have stained glass windows here, right in back of me, maybe by Rosh Hashanah, maybe after Rosh Hashanah, maybe by some Rosh Hashanah, whatever the case is going to be, okay? And so when the sun comes through there in the morning, is going to come with all the different colors. Now, hopefully nobody's going to assume that the sun is multicolored. Hopefully they're going to realize that there's only one source of light, and it's just the window that's causing the light to emanate in different colors. That would be the greatest hope, but who knows? Some people may delude themselves into believing that it's not one light, but rather different lights. Okay, like I said, I don't think most people would delude themselves like that, but that is what they say about God. That's the point. In other words, they see the God through the spectrum of all-powerful, all-knowing, and if God does not fit those categories for them, then they don't like it. Okay, so that's the point he's making here. Contemplate, therefore, God's creations from the smallest of them to the largest and delve into what has formerly eluded you. And with God's help, you will find that they are as I have told you. Because the traces of God's wisdom in creation are varied, we must contemplate and ponder them until the whole matter is settled in our souls and established in our hearts.
Oh, so you're saying you're going to see all different kinds of emanations of the glory of God.
Yes.
And you got to realize that they're all coming from the same source.
Correct. That's exactly what he's saying. Yes. So if the traces of God's wisdom have been uniform in all created things, no one would have any doubts about it.
Oh.
Okay. The learned and the simple would have been equally able to recognize it. The reason the created things are not uniform is as follows. When a thing acts in a certain way, this indicates that its actions are not the expression of its own will, but only of the nature imposed upon it. That there is some force that compels it to act in this fashion, and that it can act no differently. For example, the only power in fire is to burn. Water by nature can only cool. One who acts out of free will, however, acts in various ways at various times. You understand? We all have free will. We can do what we want. I can sit, I can move, I can jump, I can talk, I cannot. But this computer can only do one thing. Sit. If I program it to compute, it will compute. If I don't do anything to it, it just sits there. Doesn't do anything. It's worthless. Say it again?
It's not a computer then. You got a one.
No, if I turn it off, it can't do anything.
Yeah.
It's still a computer. Okay? If I don't program it, it doesn't take the program. It's still a computer. It still has a hard drive, is what we call a computer. Until I program it, it's nothing. It's worthless. It's a piece of garbage. Well, it may be a piece of garbage otherwise too, even after it's programmed. But the point is that it can't do anything without me telling it. But and when I tell it to do it, it does it. It has no choice. Okay? If somebody corrupts my programming, now it has a choice. Well, quote unquote choice. But it really doesn't. It can only do what the program is telling it to do. That's why if you don't program it properly, it doesn't work properly. Okay? Your car is the same thing. Your car doesn't have a choice as to what to do. You turn the key. Either it's going to work because everything is working properly, or it doesn't. Okay? But a human does have that choice. I can do whatever I want. That's my point. That's his point. Okay? Since the Creator, may he be exalted, has free will in whatever he does, is neither compelled nor forced, and has no given nature, he created diverse things according to the dictates and timing of his wisdom, so that their diversity would indicate his oneness and free will in all his actions, as it says, whatever God willed, he did in heaven and on earth. God knows if it is on this account that all things were not created in one image and one likeness. Rationally, it would seem that this is the reason for diverse signs of wisdom in creation. His wisdom is unfathomable, but we have mentioned one out of many other aspects which we have not grasped. Consummate wisdom belongs only to God, and there is no power beside him. So again, God is the only one who has free will. He is his implant. I mean, what we also have to say is God gave us free will. He implanted it with us. But let's face it, he can take it away whenever he wants to. The proof is? What? Yeah, the proof is Pharaoh. Who else? Nebuchadnezzar. The proof is so many people who have hit Yimach Shemo, opened two fronts at once. It was, what are you, a moron? The answer is yes. The answer is yes. But he should have done it. If he, logically, you get rid of one, you get, you know, open two fronts. You know, another idiot, another historical idiot, Achashverosh. Why is he an idiot? Because he had the choice. Do I befriend the people close to me, in other words, living in my area, or do I try to befriend the people far, far away, at the edge of his kingdom? What would you say? What was the best thing to do if you wanted to have a strong kingdom? Close or far? You have a 50-50 chance of being wrong.
Like your advisors or just the general population?
You want to be strong. You want your kingdom to remain. So yes, I'm talking about the people too.
Around
you, correct. That's what you do. What did he do? He went far out. He wanted to make friends with the people far, far away because he was afraid of them coming to attack. The rabbi said, what are you, an idiot? You want to keep the people close to you happy because then they'll protect you against those people far away. You don't have to worry about that. But that's what I'm saying. God makes people foolish. God controls us when he so desires. We also don't have free will unless God gives it to us. God's the only one who has free will. To do what he wants.
Ultimate free will.
Ultimate, right. Nobody can control God. God's the creator.
Yeah.
That's what his point to. Okay? That's number one. So now, is one obligated to reflect on creation? So he says, one is obligated, he's saying. Yes, you are obligated. To reflect on created things and deduce from them proofs of the creator's wisdom by the dictates of reason, scripture, and rabbinic tradition. That's very interesting. He's saying three things. The first thing he's picking on, though, is reason. You would have thought that he should have said by scripture, rabbinic tradition, and reason.
Yeah.
Right? But yeah. Reason last.
Huh.
First, let's have, no, he's saying no. Has to be by reason. You have to have reason. And then you go to scripture. Because once I start thinking about it, I'm going to say, oh, this was going on. And then I'm going to be reading Tehillim or whatever. I'm going to see it in scripture. And then I'll see what the rabbi is saying. Then it all makes sense to me. Because if I don't think about it first, then I can be reading the same verses over and over and over and over again and not even realize what they're talking about. Yeah.
I don't know about the scripture and
the rabbinic traditions,
but isn't that kind of how Avram did it, or Abraham? I think it was Avram.
Avram didn't have scripture.
I know, that's what I said.
He did by reason.
Just reason, and then sort of taught people along the way.
Right. So Avram Avinu did it by reason. There was no scripture or rabbinic tradition at that time. He had Shem Ve'Ever. You want to argue that maybe, but you know, it was Noah's kids. So he had that, but otherwise he's not really having anything else to base himself on. But yeah, Avram, we say about Avram that he was doing it through reason. That's why he looked at the sun, at the moon, you know, strong, the winds, so on and so forth. So we are bound by reason to do so, for the mind testifies that the superiority of a rational creature over an irrational one lies in its superior ability to perceive, to understand, and to assimilate the knowledge of wisdom's secrets which pervade the universe. As it says, who has taught us more than the beasts of the earth and made us wiser than the birds of the heaven? When a man thinks of and contemplates the foundations of wisdom and reflects upon its manifestations, his superiority over the beast is in proportion to his understanding. If he ignores them, he is not equal to the beast, but inferior to it. As scripture says, an ox knows his owner, and a donkey his master's stall. But Israel does not know, my people do not give thought. does not give thought. In other words, we reject God, we fight God, we do it. We don't recognize our master. And he's saying, and which is the negative. If we recognize him, we see all things, so then we are better than the animal, because, and if not, not, because why? The ox knows his owner. In other words, the dog knows he's going to feed him. The fish, a simple fish in a fish tank, knows when you're coming that you're going to give him, assuming you're a good guy, is going to give him, or it, whatever, food. Your cat, even though the cats are finicky and be crazy, but they also know and will bother you if you don't feed them on time. Okay? Dogs will look at you with those sad eyes and say, well, okay. So, you know, animals know their master. They do. And even if they're not, even if you're not the master, because Bill has some, what do you have? You have cats that aren't yours, right? Mm-hmm. They're the wild cats. But he has them on his, and they wait for him. Okay? Because he feeds them. That's what happens when you feed people.
They have schedules.
Right. Okay. So we are bound by Scripture to reflect on creation in the following verses. It says, lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? When I see, then also when I see your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have made, do you not know? Have you not heard? Were you not told from the very beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? Is all the prophet Yeshua who's speaking. And then he says, you deaf ones, listen. You blind ones, look and see. That's, yeah, you get the, do you get the irony here. You deaf ones, listen. In other words, you're not really deaf. You're really deaf. What it's saying, you're acting deaf. So open your, and the same thing with blind. So better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. For that is the end of every man, that let the living then meditate in his heart. So again, that's something else we have to think of. That, and it's a very interesting thing, that to go to a house of mourning is better than going, for this sort of thing, to recognize that Hashem's in charge, than to go to a house, house of feasting. The wise man, his eyes are in his head, but the fool walks around in darkness. And again, but the path of the righteous is like the light of the dawn, which builds in brilliance until full day. The way of the wicked is as thick darkness, in which they do not know over what they stumble. So all these different things are, all these different verses are his proof that we are obligated to look around in creation and to recognize that God is there. Yes, we can be foolish. Yes, we can be blind. Yes, we can be deaf to what's going on. But if we just open our eyes and our ears and our hearts, we will see God in everything we do. We are also bound by rabbinic tradition to reflect on creation in the following statements. Whoever knows how to calculate the astronomical cycles and stars and does not do so of him, Scripture says, they have lyre and harp, timbrel and flute, and wine at their feasts, and they do not notice God's works, nor do they see his handiwork. Again, this is Yeshaya. From where do we know that one is obligated to calculate the cycles and the stars? From the verse it says in Devarim, keep them and do them. For this is your wisdom and the understanding and the sight of nations who will hear all of these rules. What wisdom and understanding is in the sight of the nations? Say it is a calculation of cycles and stars. Now this is something that has baffled, when people learn it, baffled them greatly. Because if you look at the Jewish calendar, we're talking Hillel the Second. Okay, we're talking Second Temple times.
Yeah.
135? No, Second Temple was 70. It was destroyed in 70 CE, what?
70 was destroyed.
70 CE is destroyed. So maybe 100, whatever. So they still went a little more. You have to Google that. Maybe 200, whenever they have to get to the calendar, when they fix the calendar. To calculate the, to the to the ninth?
There's a Gemara somewhere says to, out to six decimal points.
Six decimal points. The there you go. Six decimal points to calculate that out and to get it right.
NASA proved them correct.
Right. To calculate that and get it right. That shows a tremendous wisdom. They didn't have it back then. So here you have the rabbis coming up with this ancient formula. They didn't, you know, and so on and so forth, to figure out how to fix the calendar which we use to this very day. That is what he's talking about. If you look at that, and people look and say, no, it must be messed up. Then again, NASA proves us right, Baruch Hashem.
NASA took it out to seven decimal places. And if you round it appropriately, whether it was up or down, it comes out to those six.
There you go. So that's what you have to look at. That's what he's saying. Now he didn't. Now Reb Bachya didn't know about NASA.
Yeah.
But NASA verifies what he's saying.
Yeah.
Probably never saw a slide roll either.
Okay. Yeah. Consider the cost, and then he says, consider the cost of a mitzvah against its reward. This is from Pirkei Avot. And the gain in sin against this loss. If the Torah had not been given to Israel, there's another statement they make in the Erevin. If the Torah had not been given to Israel, we could have learned modesty from a cat, chastity from a dove, good manners from the rooster, and honesty from the ant. Okay. Say it again.
Good manners from the rooster.
Good manners from the rooster. I'll leave that to you. I'll leave that to you. I don't know. I'm not sure. I can't answer everything. I don't know what they're referring to. So the obligation to reflect on created things and deduce proofs from traces of wisdom have been demonstrated. Be aware of this. Or as he would say in Hebrew, know this. Okay. By the way, I also wouldn't have said honesty from the ant. I would have said diligence.
Diligence. Yeah.
That's what I would have said from the ant.
Okay. They were
hard work.
Hard workers. Right. I would have said that. More than
you mean to translate this word? You mean are you changing? What do you mean?
I would have said if I was going to look at what I was going to learn. So it would be interesting why you'd have to go to the Gemara and Erevin to find out why they picked on these midot versus the other ones, because like I said, I would have gone the other way. Okay. Sometimes you look at what he's saying, you just go with what he's, you know his major point here. So you go along with the point. He's only quoting. But like I said, sometimes you have to look at the Gemaras and say, like, you guys have a problem with good manners from roosters. Yeah. Why?
Well, they have their relations everywhere. Whatever there is a hand around them, if they're in the mood, they'll have relations with them.
No, that's not, that has to do with manners. That has to do with they're loose. That they're good manners would be, you know, how you doing, their rights to other things, whatever.
Yeah, no, they're not.
Okay, so I don't know. So.
And they're sloppy eaters.
Yeah. Okay. That's okay, so I don't know. Like I said, it would be interesting to know why the Gemara picked on those animals. Chastity from a dove, I understand. Mars from a cat, yeah, because they don't want to do things. Although even there, I would have a question. They lick themselves all over the place. So I'm not sure, you know. But they cover their feces, right? That they cover. So maybe that's what they're looking at. So again, you have to go to that Gemara. Okay. So now, how does one reflect on creation? Reflection on creation means study. Study of the original elements of the world, of which the world is composed, of products that result from the combination of these elements, of the qualities of the constituent parts of each compound, of each compound's various uses, and of the signs of wisdom exhibited in its production, form, shape, proper functioning, and the ultimate purpose for which it was created. Now this seems to be, he's picking on science. In other words, if you look at science, he was to say, use the scientific method, and through science, through the observation of what's going on, which is all science really is observation, you will see God. You understand? So he's not saying, so this flies in the face of what we like to do today. We denigrate sciences. This is very much a thing of saying, no, we have to look at what the discoveries have been and through that again recognize God. So it's very, it's, you know, it's, he would like chemistry. He would like all these things, because when you put the chemical compounds together and you see how everything's broken down, and it's just how everything works so perfectly. It's just an amazing thing. And again, you have to like science, I guess, to appreciate that, but it's something that's there. So reflection on creation means becoming aware of the spiritual and physical elements of this world. And here's where science breaks off, because they don't recognize spiritual. They only recognize physical, what they can observe. Its causes and effects. Its rational and non-rational creatures. Its inert and active materials. Its inanimate objects and plants. Its higher and lower parts. And realizing that the Creator, may he be exalted, assembled and ordered the world perfectly, divided along clear lines, and made it in such a way that it points to him and reflects him, just as the work of a craftsmanship reflects the craftsman who created it, or a house, the builder who built it. You should know that the whole world is made up of the material and spiritual, and so innately mixed, so intimately mixed and fused, that each of them sustains the others, like the body and the soul in living creatures. Okay? In all of these, the signs of wisdom exhibited are three kinds. One, they are clear, obvious signs of wisdom, which even a fool could not fail to detect, certainly not an educated person, such as the movement of the sun above the earth, to illuminate the inhabitant regions and to benefit the created things. As scripture says, when the sun rises, they retreat and lie down in their lairs. Man goes out to his work and to his labor until evening. How manifold are your works, God! With wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creations. So just as the sun rises every day from east and sets in the west, and so on and so forth. So therefore, it's very consistent. There's never a day that the sun doesn't rise. Okay, I think you can all agree on that. Yeah. You may not see it because of the clouds or the lake effect.
Unless it's stopped.
There you go.
In which case, it's not rising somewhere.
That's right. Right. But then, if it's, by the way, you know, you talk about that. It stopped. How many times in history did it stop?
Twice.
The first one was with Moshe. Second one was with Yehoshua. First one was Moshe, second one was Yehoshua. Okay, what does that prove, by the way?
I don't know what it proves. That is a question.
Wait, what's the proof?
God's in
total control. Because what should have happened? If God wasn't controlling it, so he couldn't stop it. But what's worse is if something stopped somewhere, okay? So once that happened, we should have had massive earthquakes, we should have been thrown off kilter.
Yeah, I would think that gravity would just disappear.
Gravity, right. But gravity is magnetic.
Different force.
Right. That's what they found out.
The earth had to be turning for gravity.
No, gravity is the weak attractive force that nobody quite understands.
Okay.
There you go. It's all you're going to ask now.
All right. When did you guys stop?
Say it again?
When did God stop the sun from motion?
You asked me which war? I believe it was Amalek.
Okay. And then for Yehoshua, it was
Jericho,
right?
Yeah. Jericho? Not Jericho.
No.
It was later.
It was a war, though, right?
It was later war. It wasn't Jericho.
It was the proof of King Wrong.
I don't think it was Jericho.
Wasn't the proof of King Wrong? The king said
anything? No, it was a war. He was running. I don't think it was Jericho, though. I'm pretty sure. I think it was probably I. Not sure.
Greatly disturbed anybody who was on the other side of the planet.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, they had 24 hours of dark. Right. So you can imagine.
If Moshe lived, so it's within the same, like same 40 or 50 years, so. But it stops the sun for Moshe, and then like 40, 50 years later, it stops it for Yahshua. Is this going to be a regular occurrence or something?
Probably. The science probably came up with that. Yeah. As a matter of fact, you know what they said about the flood, not to get too lost in this, but they said that every 1,000 some odd years, the the sky collapses and we flood. That's what science is saying. It's okay. Science will make up anything they want. It all sounds good. Okay. But the point is, God controls it all. Number two, signs of wisdom which remain undetected by most people. Only the intelligent and insightful appreciate the good in them, such as death, which embraces all living things and serves the world's welfare. As our sages of blessed memory expounded, and God saw all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And behold, it was very good. This refers to death. So too, the wise man Solomon said, I praised the dead who have already died more than the living who still live. Okay, fine. So it's interesting. You would not think that death was a positive sign, but here we're saying, no, that works into the system, and that was good. Signs of wisdom which are observable. Why, by the way, why is death good? Okay, I mean, that would be one thing. It keeps man from believing he's God, I guess you could say that. But if everybody's living forever, then we're all gods, right? So, but what would be another thing? If I know that I'm not going to die, I don't have to do repentance, right? There's never a time I always have time. I have time. I don't have to get married that quickly. I have time. Everything I have time for.
Not
so is your motive, right? Sorry. You're not motivated to do anything. So it's the most amazing thing that when parents are alive, when both your parents are alive, you don't feel the aging process. You think you're immortal because your parents are still alive. Once one of them dies, it has to be a parent, by the way. It's not just not even a grandparent will do this to you. Once a parent dies, you realize you're next. That's when mortality hits you. Before then, you think you're immortal. But that's when mentality really hits you. When you know that you're the next one, hopefully both parents will pass on before you, but in the world that we like to live in. But nonetheless, once that first parent dies, that's when you start thinking, uh-oh, and now I have to start doing. And now if you were married, now you're going to get married. And you want the kids, and you need to get the next generation going. Because God knows that, you know, you're around the corner, right? Yeah. So that's why if you would live forever, you never have that.
You lose a parent, you're suddenly the elder.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. When you lose a parent, that's, again, you can lose a grandparent, you can lose an elder relative, it means nothing.
Yeah,
you lose a parent, that's it. That's it. That's done. As we say, as so commonly said in this part of the world, sticking a fork in him, he's done. You realize you're next. And so it's a real awakening. It, him, whatever. Okay. I'll accept it. It could be it too. Huh?
Him, it.
Oh, there you go. Good. I'm glad. It's very good. I'm glad you said that. Okay. So, like I said, signs of wisdom. Oh, I said that. Right? No, I didn't. Three. Signs of wisdom which are observable from one aspect but hidden from another. A person of limited insight will fail to recognize them unless he focuses on them and studies them closely, such as the changing conditions of the four seasons and the like. Again, these work continually. It never stops. Regardless of how cold it is right now in the springtime versus the winter, it's still working properly. Okay, a wise and insightful individual will distill from this world and the knowledge of its spirituality and subtle things, and using this knowledge like a ladder, he will attain proofs of the Creator of all, may he be exalted, and devote himself to God's service. The depth of his devotion will be in proportion to the depth of his feeling for God's greatness and glory, his perception of the signs of God's goodness and mercy toward all his creatures, and his recognition that God endowed him with an abundance of favors and raised him on high because he has done, I'm sorry, before he has done anything or assumed any fine trait of character to deserve such a reward from him. Next, he will select for himself from the physical elements of the world the things that support his body and promote his material well-being. but only enough to meet his needs and provide for his livelihood. He will give up the luxuries and precious things of this world, which turn the heart away from God, and try to work for his final home and destination after death. The world and its possessions he regards as a means of providing for his appointed day and latter end. And so he takes from it only what may accompany him on his journey. Now this, again, is getting to be very spiritual, because what I cannot take with me on my ultimate journey is my money, my car, my family.
Swimming pool.
Oh, come on, I can't take that either? Okay. I can't take anything. The only thing I can take with me is the merits of the deeds that I've done. That's all that's going to help me out. Period. An individual who is ignorant of the ways of this world and unaware of the signs of wisdom found in it regards it as his permanent home and place of residence. He invests in it all of his efforts and puts his whole heart and all his energies into it, thinking that he furthers his own interests. He does not take into account the fruit of all his labor, and all the property he has amassed will go to others during his own lifetime and after his death. Thus, he totally neglects his interests in the next world. Here's something else, a famous thing. We work, we're gathering all our money, and then suddenly, when you get old and you retire, you go to the DMV, the Department of Motor Vehicles, and you get your license plate that says, "I'm spending my kid's inheritance." Because you realize there's nothing left. If you don't use it, somebody else is going to. So that's when you get that, all these funny things, and you start making investments. Not really, hopefully nobody really spends all their money on their extravagances, and they give the kid something. But nonetheless, what he's saying to you is, don't fall into this trap. If you want to have everlasting life, then you have to follow Hashem. If you want to really give your kids something, then you give them Hashem. You don't give them possessions. Possessions, while they're very nice and they'll get you, you know, to do something, very nice, and we all need them, we all love them, we all have our 15 cars. But the point, exaggeration. Okay. But the point is that we want to give our kids something, and what we want to give them is something of value. The value, Rabbeinu Bachya, and everybody else in the world of Musar is telling us, is Torah. That's the value that you can go anywhere with. That never loses. Everything else loses. Stocks can go down. Yep. Businesses can crash.
Cars wear out.
Okay, everything else goes down. But when it comes to Torah, that's the only thing that is an investment that pays forever and ever and ever. And even when you're dead, it's paying dividends. That's when you're collecting your dividends, I should say, not you paying. But that's really what you're trying to do. So here we go. How analogous these two types are to two brothers who inherited from their father land, which was in need of cultivation. They divided the land into two. Neither of them possessed anything else. One of the brothers was sensible and hardworking. The other brother was quite the opposite. The sensible one realized that if he worked exclusively on his own plot of land, he would be unable to make a living and support himself. So he hired himself out as a day laborer and worked in other people's fields to earn enough to live on from day to day. After work toward evening, he would go work for an hour on his own land with intensity and vigor when he had enough left over from his wages to keep him for a day or more. He would not work for others during that time, but would work in his own field with great energy and zest. He did not break from this regimen until his land was fully cultivated. At harvest time, he gathered in his fruit and crops and lived off them all of the following year. He was free to work his land as he pleased and planted more trees until it not only produced enough for his livelihood, but yielded a surplus with which he bought additional land. The foolish brother, realizing that if he had worked the foolish brother, realizing that if he worked his own land exclusively, would not be able to support himself, neglected it entirely. He hired himself out to others as a day laborer and lived off the wages he was paid, saving nothing. By the way, this Rabbeinu Bachya could be writing this book today. That's how this example is today. Okay. When he had enough left over for his wages to provide him for food for a single day, he would take the day off to rest, loaf, seek amusement, never giving a thought to his own land. In his spare time on work days, he would go to the bathhouse. His land, meanwhile, remained desolate, produced nothing. It was overgrown with thorns. Its fences broken down. Its floodwaters had swept away its trees. As the wise man, again, the Sovi Solomon, said, I passed by the field of a lazy man, by the vineyard of a man with no sense, and lo, it was all overgrown with thorns, its surface covered up with thorn bushes, its stone fences broken down. An intelligent person, upon reflecting on this parable, will draw a lesson from it concerning his own latter end, which is his true home, and will work for it with total commitment. For his earthly needs, he will work as one does for others, only according to need for subsistence. The fool, however, does exactly the opposite. He invests his efforts in the matters of this world and neglects his interests in the next. As the wise man said when observing the fool, I observed and took it to heart. I saw and learned a lesson. If we're going to just sit and not invest in Torah, and not invest in following Hashem in this world, we're like the fool who only works for somebody else, and when you have a day off, just enjoys it. That is what he's saying to us. Like I said, he could have written this today.